Today I'm joined by Professor Ian Frazer, who is a world-renowned immunologist. And Professor Frazer was a co-inventor of technology used to develop vaccines for human papillomavirus, HPV, which are used across the world to help prevent cervical cancer. The World Health Organization has said that human papillomaviruses have been responsible for 70% of cases of cervical cancer and precancerous lesions in the cervix. So developing HPV vaccines have been an extraordinary revolution for health across the world today. So thank you, Ian, for joining us on AVAXX 101X today. And we're very honored to have you as part of the course.
Well, thank you for having me along.
So I'd just like to start by asking you questions about your background and how you got involved in developing vaccine technologies. So how did you get involved with researching and developing vaccine technologies?
When I was trained as a doctor, there was a major outbreak of one particular virus infection in the hospital where I was working, hepatitis B. And I had always been interested in how the body defends itself against infection. So that encouraged me to develop my career in the direction of understanding viruses and how we fight off viruses. And that in turn led me to move from an entirely medical career to one where there was a research component as well. And I came out to Australia in 1981, basically to pursue the research side of my career.
And as someone who's been directly involved in advancing vaccine technologies, what would you say are the key stages in the development cycle of a vaccine?
Vaccines are developed to prevent infection that must be common enough to make it worthwhile developing a vaccine. And recognition that a vaccine would be useful is actually the very first part of the story, because that encourages people to understand how the virus naturally engages with the body's own immune system and how we cure ourselves of the infections that we get. If we don't cure ourselves of a particular infection, that strongly suggests that a vaccine isn't going to work. And therefore, that's one of the reasons why we study quite closely how the body does get rid of a particular infection, to get the clues as to how to make a vaccine. Most of the initial work will be done in the laboratory, quite often with animals, possibly with cells. But once you get to the stage that you think you've got a potential vaccine, obviously you have to do clinical trials to find out if it will work. And the largest part of developing a vaccine is actually taking something which might be a vaccine and putting it through those clinical tests.
Now, what are the normal timescales involved in the development of a vaccine?
Well, how long it takes to come up with the technology depends on how tough the problem is. We're still looking for an effective technology, for example, for an HIV/AIDS vaccine after 30 years. So that does suggest that we haven't quite got the answers for that one. But given that the infection is one which the body normally can fight, then the stage to work out how you want to make the vaccine is usually quite short, 3 to 6 months. And then after that, that's when the hard work starts, because then you've got to demonstrate whether it really works rather than just whether it produces an immune response when you test an animal.
And in what ways are vaccines tested before they're released to the public?
Well, the very first part, of course, is to find out whether you can get an immune response in an animal that will protect the animal against the infection. That assumes that you have a good animal model, but for most viruses we do. Presuming that you get evidence of protection in the animal, or if there's no really good animal model, presuming that you can see an immune response to your vaccine in an animal, then you go into clinical trials. And the first clinical trials are always safety trials, and they're basically done in normal volunteers and a small group of normal volunteers at that. And they're given the vaccine at different doses to find out, first of all, if it is safe, whether it produces any immediate adverse events, which is pretty unusual for a vaccine. And then to see if a normal person given that material does make the same sort of immune response as you see in an animal. No evidence of effectiveness at that stage. All you're looking for is safety and perhaps immunogenicity. The next step after that, obviously, is to extend those trials, first of all, to look in a broader range of people, maybe people who have got a particular health problem, or older people or children, depending on which group you're going to try and use the vaccine in. Again, still primarily looking at safety. now also you might look again at immunogenicity. And if it's a common infection, you might even start to think about looking to see if there's protection. But it's really only when you get to the phase three clinical trials that you really start thinking about protection. And there, the trial will be one where there will be volunteers who get the vaccine, and then there will be volunteers who get a placebo of some sort, maybe another vaccine for a different purpose, or maybe just salt water. And then what you're really looking at now is to see whether the vaccine protects those individuals. And they will, I mean, hopefully will be protected against getting sick. They might be totally protected against getting infected. Mm-hmm. Most vaccines really just prevent you from getting sick with the infection. They're not designed specifically to make sure you never get the infection, just to make sure you never get sick with it. Once you've gone through a big phase three trial, you're now starting to think about whether you can use the vaccine or not. You're still always looking at safety data. That carries on all the way through every study, and long after the vaccine's licensed for use, you're still looking at safety. But even once you've done one phase three study, you're going to have to do several, because you need to go and look again in people who might not be so easily vaccinated, the elderly, people who've got a damaged immune system. So you want to do a study specifically in them to see if it works. Then you maybe need to do different population groups, because not everybody responds the same way to viruses, and not everybody therefore will respond the same way to vaccines. And it's very important to think about all the different ethnic groups that you might want to test. And always safety at the top of the list. Did this vaccine cause any problems? Because even if you find it's perfectly safe in 100 people, it doesn't mean that one in 100,000 people isn't going to get a serious side effect. And you will only learn that once you've immunized 100,000 people.
Yeah. So you mentioned that about this constant monitoring of safety. How does that monitoring occur after a vaccine has been released to the public?
It depends from country to country how that's done. In Australia, we can, if you're somebody who immunizes people, you can fill out a form if you think somebody's had a bad reaction to the vaccine, and that gets sent centrally, and then people compile all these forms, and if something crops up more than once, you start getting a bit worried. In the United States, there's a thing called the Vaccine Adverse Events Registry, which collects very similar data. And these, it generally tends to be the developed world countries that do the most of the monitoring post-release of a vaccine to make sure that it's totally safe. But even once you've got the vaccine out there, you're always collecting data. And because you don't know how common a particular side effect's going to be in a particular group, anything that happens to somebody while you're doing a trial, and quite a lot of things that happen even after you finish the trials and you're routinely using the vaccine, will get recorded. So you have a motor vehicle accident while you're doing the trial. Mm-hmm. That's listed as an adverse event. It doesn't mean the vaccine caused it, but at least you've got the data. Because if you don't collect everything that happens, something that might be related to the vaccine might be missed.
So everything is collected, just if it's correlated at all with vaccine receipt.
Yes, that's right. And that's actually one of the big problems, because we have to decide what we mean by correlated. I mean, If it happens today and you got vaccinated today, yes, it's possibly related. But what happens if you get an illness in 6 months' time that somebody thinks might be due to the vaccine? That's always a common concern. It was a particular concern for the papillomavirus, the cervical cancer vaccine, because that was the first vaccine that was being routinely given to girls in their teens. And quite a number of illnesses first present to girls in their teens. Right. And therefore, obviously people were concerned if their daughter got a particular illness and they'd had the vaccine 6 months or a year previously, could that have been responsible? So then you have to have a really good understanding of how common that disease is in the general community before the vaccine became available, and how that relates to what's happening now the vaccine's around.
So as a researcher who's worked on developing vaccine technologies, you have insider knowledge and expertise that many people don't have. So with that knowledge, what would you tell the people in the public about the safety of vaccination?
What I would say is that the vaccines that we routinely use at the moment are well mapped out. Mm-hmm. We know exactly what the side effects might be of those vaccines. They're all rare and mostly not serious. So we can be very confident that the vaccines that we're routinely using at the moment are safe enough that they're far better than not having the vaccine, which is, after all, the main reason why you get a vaccine. You're well, you want to stay well, and therefore you want to make sure that the vaccine will be safer than not having the vaccine. For the new vaccines that come along, we have new technologies, and therefore this is going to be a little bit more difficult. Up till now, basically, there have been essentially just two different ways of making vaccines. One is to grow up the virus that causes the problem and make it less virulent so it doesn't make you sick, but makes your immune system think they've had the infection so you're protected for the next time. And the other way is to make something that looks like the virus and make it dead so it can't cause any problems. And then again, it tricks your immune system into thinking it's seen this before and therefore you're protected. But now we have all these new technologies involving DNA vaccines, RNA vaccines, recombinant protein vaccines, which are being used in a way that we haven't got a great deal of experience for. So for these ones, we're still learning. We believe these vaccines will be safe. We believe that they will be as safe as the ones that we're currently using. They have, these new technologies, some big advantages for vaccine development, which is why we're using them. First of all, some of them will work to make vaccines that we can't make by the other technologies that we've previously been using. Some of them have the big advantage that we can make a lot of them very quickly, which in the current circumstances is actually rather important, because there's no point in having a vaccine that's very effective but takes ages to make when we've got a pandemic going on.
Now, you mentioned the issue of correlative illnesses that result possibly following getting a vaccine. And in relation to the HPV vaccine, anecdotally, one of the things that I've encountered is people specifically mentioning the HPV vaccine as being problematic, or people voicing opposition to the HPV vaccine specifically. What do you make of public opposition to the HPV vaccine?
Well, the funny thing is that there's not much public opposition to it. There's a lot of noise, but there's not much opposition. There are two groups of people who have used the HPV vaccine for their own purposes. One, perhaps unsurprisingly, is that group of people who fundamentally believe that all vaccines are bad. That's not a rational belief. And indeed, if they thought about the epidemics of infection that used to occur, they probably wouldn't even start talking about it, but they're entitled to their opinion. There's no evidence to support it, of course. But the other group is basically that there's a group of people who have jumped on the bandwagon of creating publicity for themselves through rubbishing vaccines, so that they get the sympathy vote from the people who are absolutely against vaccines, but they also get a vote of people who like to believe everything they read on the web or in a newspaper or whatever. And they attract attention not so much to the vaccine, but to themselves. Judicial Watch in the United States would be an excellent example of that group that have used vaccines as a handle to get the interests of people who are more interested in a sort of minimalist government approach, no interference from above type story. So that these two groups are the main groups that cause problems. The big problem from the practical point of view is that both of those groups and the people that they attract to their groups influence other people who might otherwise have got their kids vaccinated. And that's okay in this part of the world where 95% of the population get most of the vaccines they need. But even 95% doesn't stop a measles outbreak. And it just takes a little bit of loss of confidence in vaccines to suddenly have measles pandemics, because we've had several major outbreaks of measles in the last 2 years, including one big one in Madagascar, where about a third of the population got measles. And that was simply because the vaccine hadn't got into that community for a range of reasons. But people soon start queuing up for vaccines that their children haven't had when a virus or a bacterium is going around. The outbreak of diphtheria last year, for example, and there was anything that creates a problem, people suddenly realize, well, maybe vaccines are a better bet.
So you mentioned some of the issues surrounding new vaccines. What new vaccine technologies are on the horizon that people can be looking forward to?
Well, probably the one that would give people the greatest pleasure would be if we didn't have to use a needle and syringe to deliver the vaccine. And there are a range of technologies that are now being tried that would enable us to avoid needle and syringe. There are big advantages to doing that, of course, not least of which is that people don't like needles and syringes, but also they can be easier packaged, mm-hmm. and they can also be made in a way that doesn't require a cold chain. Therefore, they can be distributed in parts of the world where cold chains are difficult. One of the technologies that's being trialled, of course, is one that was developed here at the University of Queensland, which is basically a nanoneedle patch, which is basically a bit of furry stuff that you can stick on your skin. It's got needles, but they're so small that you don't even know they're there. And it delivers the antigen, the vaccine, straight into your skin, which is actually the best place to put it because that's where your immune system works best. So that's the sort of technologies that we're developing. But there are also other means. There's what used to be euphemistically called the gene gun, where you can just shoot things into the skin ballistically. And that also delivers antigen relatively painlessly. And again, doesn't need a needle and syringe. We're always looking for oral vaccines. Mm-hmm. That's harder. We haven't yet got many oral vaccines that are very satisfactory. And they, when they are satisfactory, they tend to be satisfactory against infections that infect your gut, unsurprisingly. Right. So we have different bits to our immune system. Our gut has one, our lungs have another, and the whole of the rest of our body has a third bit. And most of the viruses that cause problems infect the rest of the body rather than the gut or the lungs.
Well, thank you very much for answering those questions. Do you have any other thoughts or ideas that if you were addressing an audience that was interested in vaccine hesitancy and some of the issues that people have in terms of fears about vaccines, do you have any other thoughts that you would let students know about vaccinations and and vaccines?
Well, I think the most important thing to understand is just how bad the pandemics of infection were before mm-hmm. vaccines came along. The 19 flu epidemic killed a quarter of the world's population. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. pretty impressive.
Yeah.
If on average, wealthy families in the Victorian era used to have 10 to 12 children because on average two or three of them would reach adult life, the other succumbing to infection during childhood, such as diphtheria, measles. And people will say, well, okay, measles is a trivial illness. Well, it's not a trivial illness. It's trivial enough for the 990 people that don't get a serious complication out of 1,000, 5 of the 1,000 will die from encephalitis and another 5 will be left with permanent brain damage. So, you know, it's a matter of risks and rewards, if you like. People mm-hmm. should understand that all these infections are still around, mm-hmm. and that we're protected in part by the fact that everybody else has been immunized. But if you want to make sure your kids are safe, and remember, they may wander off into parts of the world when they grow up where these infections are still prevalent. If you want to make sure they're protected when they go there, make sure they're immunized when they're children.
And that's been a significant concern with the measles outbreaks that have occurred in many countries that had been at one time declared free of endemic measles. It's from people traveling overseas and then bringing measles back to populations that are under-vaccinated, and it spreads so rapidly.
Yeah. Well, measles is the classic example of a virus that spreads rapidly through an unimmunized community and infects almost everybody that's exposed. One person with measles will infect on average 90 people who are not immune to it. And that's the average. So it's very rapidly spread through the community if they're not immunized. Conversely, that means that you have to have at least 95% coverage in the community to stop it spreading like that. And that's why we're so insistent that kids should get the measles vaccine when they're young and get a booster in teenage years to make sure they're fully protected.
To ensure that they're protected moving forward. Now, in terms of you mentioned a little bit about getting into developing vaccine technology. Did you have an aha moment when you were developing the HPV vaccine where something just clicked and you had that, you know, you had that insight that no one else had for tackling this incredibly serious virus?
It wasn't quite like that. First of all, my colleague Jan and I didn't set out to make a vaccine against HPV. We set out to understand better how the virus worked as a virus. At the time that we were doing that work, it wasn't even really fully appreciated how much of cervical cancer was caused by papillomavirus or how common the infection was in the community. All we knew was that this was a virus that was in some way linked to cervical cancer. Harold Serhousen's work had shown that quite clearly, or at least his postdoc's work. He took the credit, and I think the postdocs did most of the work. But the bottom line is that we knew that was a strong link. We set out to make the virus in the laboratory because you can't grow it in the lab. And most viruses you can grow in the lab quite easily, but this particular virus still hasn't been effectively grown in the lab. So we set out using genetic engineering, which was a relatively new technology at that time, to make the components of the virus. And much to our surprise, when we made the major shell protein, the coat, if you like, of the virus in the lab, it self-assembled into these things that we call virus-like particles, which actually resemble the virus. It's not, the virus is made up of 360 copies of that protein. And in the test tube, if we did it right, and that was the difficult bit, if we did it right, they self-assembled. And yes, there was an aha moment, because having tried for a year to get them to self-assemble with many different variations on the same theme without success, we eventually got back an electron micrograph, a picture of a fully assembled virus. And we realized not only that we'd got where we wanted to in terms of making a potentially infectious virus that we could work with in the lab, we also now had the potential basis for a vaccine. At least I certainly saw that and told the university that that was what it would potentially be, which has turned out to be correct.
That must have been quite the experience when you got that microscopic image back.
Well, we put a year of work into trying to get to that point, and maybe we got a bit blasé about it, because I do remember discussing it with my wife and saying, well, this might be some significant someday. You know? But remember, at that time, we still didn't understand the epidemiology of the infection.
Right,
so we didn't realize that this was a virus which was actually very common in the community, that it spread very rapidly through young people, that only 1 in 100 or thereabouts of people who get the virus will go on to get a cancer in the cervix. But there are also other cancers, including oropharyngeal cancer, which is now a much bigger problem than cervical cancer, that are caused by the same virus. So that the size of the problem wasn't really known to us at that time. You know, we had a rough idea it might be something that was worth a vaccine, but we didn't know that. And it was really only the work that was done subsequently by a number of people in the United States public health epidemiologists who just mapped out just how common the infection was as the tools became available to do that, and realized that this is in fact a virus that almost all of us get when we're young and sexually active.
So that work that you were doing then met a need that you hadn't realized.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. We didn't set out to make a vaccine.
Right.
We set out to do something else, but it turned out to be a vaccine. Incidentally, the first that was made using that technology. You know, that there was a new technology which we were lucky enough to be able to get our hands on at that time. We realized that technology would be necessary to make the shell of the virus. We just didn't realize that it would self-assemble. If we'd known that, we would have thought more seriously about a vaccine a bit earlier.
And how has that influenced other vaccine development?
Well, now we have a number of vaccines that are made using the same sort of technology, and including the one that SARS virus that they're developing here, the COVID-19 vaccine, that uses very similar technology. Now it's a routine technology that all labs use, not necessarily to make vaccine, just to make protein. But in those days, that was new. Making proteins in what they call eukaryotic cells, mammalian cells, was a new technology and not a straightforward one in those days. Now it's routine and anybody can do it in the lab. I mean, the big art with the COVID-19 vaccine is rather to work out exactly what bits to put into the vaccine to get the maximum effect.
Right.
So that's another level of challenge, because we really do. When you're throwing a new virus, you don't know enough about it when you first encounter it to work out exactly what the right things to do are. So people have concentrated on one bit of the virus, and it's probably the right one, but we don't know enough from the natural history of the infection to be sure about that. That we're learning as we go along from the people who have been unfortunate enough to get the infection. We're trying to work out which part of the immune response that the body naturally makes to the infection looks like it might be important and protective. So that we have to learn after the event. We'll have the vaccines, and there are 20 in trial at the moment, and we'll match them up to what we've learned about what sort of immune response is likely protective. And then that will probably tell us which of the vaccines that we'll want to use in the long term to control the infection.
Well, thank you, Ian, for joining us on AVAXX 101. It's been a great honor, and it's definitely of benefit to all the students who are taking this course.
Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure to take part.
Thank you.